A pleasant good morning to you all once again. I'm happy to welcome Professor K. Muni, who is presently Dean School of Civil Engineering, VIT Chennai campus. So I'm very happy to welcome you, sir, for the ACT Atal sponsored faculty development program. So I'm I should be very much thankful to Dr. K. Muthumani because he has readily given his consent to deliver the keynote lecture in this particular FDP. So thank you so much, sir, for that. So before starting the technical session, so I'm happy to introduce Dr. K. Muthumani to the audience. So Dr. K. Muthumani is presently Dean School of Civil Engineering, VIT Chennai. So he worked as a scientist in CSIR, Structural Engineering Research Center, Tharamani, Chennai. So from 1980 to 2015, so he's a fine researcher and leading consultant in the area of power plant structures and earthquake engineering. So Dr. K. Muthumani, after obtaining his BE Honours degree in Civil Engineering from Government College of Technology, Coimbatore, he has proceeded to Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, where he obtained his M.Tech degree and Ph.D. degree. He was awarded Institute Gold Medal for his position in M.Tech. So Dr. K. Muthumani made a notable contribution in the area of structural dynamics and earthquake engineering. He has guided about 6 PhD students. He received Dr. Ramayya Prize for 3 years for the best papers published. So far, he has published about 145 papers in national and international journals and conferences. He visited University of Karlsruhe, Germany for proposing a project on seismic stability of West Coast India. He also did Japan and Taiwan on official duty. He is a fellow of Indian Society for Earthquake Technology, Fellow of Institution of Engineers, Indian Concrete Institute, and Indian Geotechnical Society. He was also a member of various BIS code committees. So we are very fortunate to have Dr. K. Muthumani in this occasion. So once again, I welcome Dr. K. Muthumani for this program on behalf of all the participants present here. So welcome you, sir. So now the session is over, Dr. K. Muthumani.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for the nice words. I hope everyone is seeing this and also hearing me. Can someone say yes?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. So I am extremely happy to address a large audience. But it would have been happier if we have been meeting in person so that we will see the visibility of physical presence all over. So given the fact that we are in such a bad situation, hope and pray that best things happen in course of time. I'm extremely happy to address the CIACT Atal Academy Online FDP on earthquake resistant structural system arranged by this AC. So SEC. So I am extremely happy to address all of you on this nice occasion and thank the HOD for inviting me to give this introduction to earthquake engineering to all of you. So when I say the word earthquake, immediately the first thing that comes into anybody's mind is a kind of failure that happens in the buildings. So obviously, the first thing that I want to quote is Bhuj 2001, where we have seen devastating failure in every structural part in the area of Bhuj, Anjar, Ahmedabad, Gandhidham, and Port of Kantala, and many other places within this area, with the center being at Bhuj. So this is the first impression that we get, that earthquake means a lot of buildings that fail. Obviously, there let me say Ahmedabad, where there are about, let me say, 20 high-rise building fail. But there are 200 other buildings which did not fail. So there is obviously an engineering judgment that is very much required in earthquake engineering, wherein our idea is to see that how we come out of all this and have safe building and safe environment within India. So this is the main focus we should have. So that is the basis in which I would like to start the topic. So when I say earthquake, it in many places there are repercussions like surface rupture, what we have seen in Kiki earthquake. and then landslide in the area of mountains and other places. And liquefaction is a phenomenon which is really happens in the earth, where the shear resistance of the soil become almost zero. The whole building is simply tumbles. So these are all very special phenomena that happens in earthquake. In addition to that, we have seen tsunami, which is also a repercussion of earthquake that happened in our region, which reached Chennai and other east coast in a long spell. So these are all the second, you say, secondary actions of getting this earthquake into place. So of course, coming to failures, we do lose a lot of interesting structures, like for example, the historic architectural structures, which are our heritage, what we call our heritage. We used to lose at the end of an earthquake, and also we lose a lot of buildings, a lot of middle income group buildings, as well as infrastructure, bridges, so many things that we lose. So this this is a phenomenon that is how an earthquake is seen by anybody. So earthquake means that it means a lot of failure everywhere like that. So let us understand what is earthquake. Earthquake is obviously a kind of sudden slip that can occur on a fault. What is the repercussion of this? So as I see as an engineer, that means the ground is actually shaking. That is the main thing that happens. That means there is a kind of motion that is induced in the ground, maybe for a certain period. Let me say 40 seconds to 60 seconds, like that, depending upon various earthquake. That is the possible thing that can happen. The reason may be many things. There is a slip in the volcano, the plate, or volcanic activity, or magmatic activity, or any other sudden stress change in the earth. So you can explain it in so many ways. That is any of seismologists to work. So before going deep into earthquake engineering, let us briefly see how this earth formed. For example, 200 years ago, the earth mass was almost like a single landmass with few parts here and there. 80 million years ago, there are some kind of formation wherein we are able to identify certain continents like South America, North America, Africa, European. And interestingly, you see India, which was almost an island at that point of time, say 80 million years ago. So even if you say 15 million years ago, the India was only trying to reach the European continent. So the land mass is moving. This is the main message I want you to take. But this happens over millions of years. It's not within our lifetime or whatever. This is happening around millions of years. For example, even today, the Indian plate is driving to Asia at a rate of approximately 47 mm per year. So this is current data. This doesn't mean that next year it is going to be same. So obviously, there is a lot of changes that really happens in the land mass that is there within the earth, and the way in which it moves, and it affects, and it really means something to us. So in order to explain in a very brief way, I am not going to deep into seismology, but to certain extent, let me say the earth has three parts, even though it can be dealt with much more parts than three. Let me say there is something called crust, which is the top layer of the earth, and there is a mantle, which is in between, and there is a core. So let me say that this dimension is given us given here. I am not going into that. But the message is that since we are interested in the crust only, so we know what is the thickness of the crust at various parts of the map. So suppose I say India, so I know what is the crustal thickness in that plate, like that. So it is not constant. It is going to vary between 10 kilometer to 20 kilometer and so on like that. So, but what I want to tell you is this is an information that is available to us. So let us see how I can use them. So in simple terms, if I have to explain what is happening below the earth, suppose if I take a pot of water and then try to heat, there is something called convection of heat that happens. Actually, we have the heat at the bottom from the stove, and the water particle at the bottom gets heated up, and then the particle moves up, and the cold particle at the top comes down. And there is a cyclic movement. This is what is called convection of heat in the water. That is how the water gets heated up. The same way, if you see earth, there is something called core, where the temperature of that core is very high, and compared to crust, which is our normal temperature, and in between there is a variation. So this variation is going to have this kind of convection of heat issue in the particle motion, which is within this. So this is a possibility. This is one simple theory that we can give to explain this. So when I say that the crust, which I say continents, whichever way you want to call them, or tectonic plate, whatever you want, way you want to call them, what really happens is, because the earth is being circular, there are possibilities that the plate can move away from each other, continent move away from each other, or there is a possibility in some other place they move towards each other. So this is what we call divergent boundary and convergent boundaries. So these are all very much explained in the seismology. So we are able to understand what is happening. This is one thing I want you to know. This what is happening in the earth plate and how do they move and what kind of motion that really happens. All these things are very much clear in our understanding. For example, this is a subduction zone, what we call subduction zone. That is when this Australian plate and Pacific plate move each other towards each other, converging plate, after some time it is not able to go any further. Either it can go up like what happened in Himalayas, or it can go down like what you see here, Pacific plate. So this example says subduction zone. This is what subduction zone. It is a very serious area from where earthquake in this region will be of very high order. So this is one point that I want you to remember. Of course, there are a variety of other faults, what we call transform faults, which is a simple example be San Andreas fault. The transform fault is like this. One layer goes left and another goes lays right. That means something like shear of layer that happens. So this is one possibility that we can think of. And there is also a divergent boundary that can happen. So plates do interact in various possible ways. There are more than one way of doing it. And given a fact that there can be a transform plate boundary, or a convergent plate boundary, or a divergent plate boundary, or a subduction zone. These are all four major divisions. It doesn't mean that there cannot be some minor divisions still. It is a possibility. But what I am trying to say is, suppose I have a world map here. I know what are all the places where these plates are moving, and what type of boundaries are there, whether it is transform plate boundary or convergent plate boundary or divergent, whatever I know, that I know. And also at what rate it moves. Like I was talking about Indian plate. Any plate which moves, every year we take this data and we have the data in the USGS site. So you can always get how these plates are moving, at what rate, and all those things. So these are the information we are using, which we can get some idea. So this is how tectonic plate moves. So the major earthquake that happens in the world is mainly because of this major tectonic plates. Of course, that doesn't mean that the intra plates can also create trouble. So that is a different issue. I am just talking about major tectonic blocks. So there can be three types of fault, as I told you: the normal fault, reverse fault, strike slip fault. Like that, there are three possible failure mode can be there. So these are all available in physics of geophysics subject. So this science is very good. So that way we are able to understand many things, and then we get certain basic ideas like what is really happening. Suppose there is an earthquake that happens at a place. The place at which it happens, we call this as focus. And the point just above on the ground is called epicenter. So this is how you may be aware. So what really happens is, wherever the ground where the breaks, or it gets some kind of entangled and then stress increase and then becoming an earthquake, there is a certain kind of wavefront that starts. So the wave front starts and then it moves across, and that is what is creating a vibration in the ground. And we are more concerned about this vibration in reality. And another point I want you to notice, for example, if I have a plot of all the earthquake that happened in the last 100 years or 1000 years, as I guess maybe, you get a set of lines, a set of points that what you see here. If I join that, I get a good line which says that this is the border of your tectonic plate, and you can simply name them at African plate because it covers the African continent. The same way I can go on doing it, and if I plot what happened in the last 1 year, and if I plot that, I get the same picture. Suppose if I plot hundreds of years, let me say 100 years I take and try to plot that, still I get the same line. So this obviously gives a picture that major tectonic plates experiences large earthquake continuously, and the magnitude may be different from time to time. That may be different because of the way in which it adjusts or something like that. So based on all this, we try to identify major tectonic plates like South American plate, African plate, Eurasian plate, North American plate, and so on, Australian plate, and so on. So this Australian plate and the Indian plate and Eurasian plate, they join together at Indonesia, very near to Indonesia. That is where we got that major earthquake which ended up in tsunami in this region. So of course, there are a variety of stories like that. So this is the first thing that we need to know as far as major things that are happening. So coming to the seismic waves, suppose an earthquake happens at one place, the wave starts. The wave starts and crosses throughout the globe. Please understand, that is a very important thing. The wave starts and goes throughout the globe. That is, earthquake can happen in one place. suppose on top of the earth something happens, at the bottom of it I can have a sensor and collect that data. So that is the way it is. So it pervades through earth. That is the first thing I want to know. The second thing is, because as I said, there are three major material difference in the earth. So when the material changes happens, there is some changes happens. For example, a wave proceeding may get reflect or refract, as the case may be. So that kind of thing also can happen because that is what physics taught us. So the major understanding in terms of the waves are, from the focus, there are two possible waves that are called the primary wave and secondary wave. The primary wave is something called compression cum tension kind of thing, compression or expansion like that. So the soil particle within the layer, it get either compression or tension. The wave moves like that by having a motion in terms of compression and tension in the soil particle. So that is what is called primary wave. The secondary wave is the soil moving up and down, something like shear. We don't use the word shear, but secondary wave. The secondary wave is very vertical up and side motion. So these are all the two waves that are emanating from the focus. Once they reach a surface, we call that as surface waves. In the surface, we have two parts again. One is called Rayleigh wave, which is again vertical motion up and down, or circular motion within the wave, or a Love wave, which is lateral motion in the ground. So we are very clear. These are, of course, this is very important to know because we need to understand this. For example, if there is a wave that is emanating at a point here, the P wave starts here. When the medium is different, suddenly there is a reflection and comes. And the wave also continues to go here. So this is a specialty of P wave, which is called the compression rarefaction wave. And this crosses all places, whether it is a medium like this or medium like a liquid in between core, everything it is crossing. So by putting a sensor somewhere, I can get, for example, within the region I get P only. Suppose within this region I get P plus PP. That means P, it gets reflected and goes here like that. And again reflected and goes here. So by putting in various places, I know how many layers it has come across or how many reflection it has come across. All that I can show. I can get from this information. But when it comes to shear wave, that is a small problem because the shear wave cannot be a shear wave or secondary wave. It cannot cross the liquid boundaries because there is a liquid core at that point it's available. So we cannot get in this region at the bottom of the earth or something like that. Suppose if you say this is a top of the earth where the earthquake happens, at the bottom of the earth, nothing will. So this is a lot of region where say S wave will not come. So by measuring, suppose I measured here, if I don't get S wave, I can say that earthquake is just opposite of this point like that. So depending upon what wave I get, I am able to identify where exactly the earthquake has happened. So measurement is a very important thing. Coming to measurement, obviously, just to say the conventional method, of course, we have today digital technologies. Just for comparing and explaining, I am just taking this paper recorder. So let me say that the ground is moving and the ground motion is recorded in a piece of paper. And this is what you get. So what you get is the first wave that arrives in the ground surface is called P wave. So obviously P wave has higher velocity than the other S wave. That is why it comes first. After some time, your S wave comes. After some time, surface wave gets amplified. So this is the way that I am able to identify these waves. So what is the use of this? But there is a very important thing that I want you to note here. One is the time of arrival of P wave. The time of arrival of P wave and the time of arrival of S wave gives an information how far the epicenter is away from the measuring point. Suppose I have a measuring point, and then if this is very short, that means the epicenter is very near. If it is very far, that means the epicenter is far away. So sorry, this is a simple thing. Yes.
Sir, are you sharing the slide?
Yes.
Nah, actually, sir, your face is coming only. You are not sharing the slides, sir. Please check it.
It is seen only. Dear participant, you can actually go to the participants list. There will be two names with sir's name, Dr. K. Muthumani. In one, it will be saying presentation. You can go to that and you will have a pin symbol. If you click on that, you will be able to see the screen.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
So you can share, sir.
One second, because I stopped sharing. Are you seeing now? Are you seeing my screen?
No, sir. We can't see, sir.
Everyone getting it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
I think you're all getting it. Yes. Can I proceed?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I will go to slide sharing, slide full screen mode.
So you have a small box saying you're sharing your entire screen, no, sir, the small box.
Yes.
That alone you can move it down because that is obstructing the slide.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Hope you are in full screen mode.
Yes, sir.
And everyone is seeing very good. So if there is some other problem, please stop me. No issue. So the curve that you are seeing is the first wave that arrives is called P wave, and the second wave that arrives is called S wave. The difference between this time, the time of arrival, the difference between this shows that how far the epicenter is away from the measuring point. Suppose I measure at a particular point and this time is very short, that means I am very near to epicenter. And this time is very long, that means I am far away from epicenter. So this is the way that I can understand this in a simple way. So this is, distance by time is velocity. The same way, this same expression is used to find out the distance, because we are able to measure the distance, that is TP, where the time of arrival of P, TS, where time of arrival of secondary wave. So obviously there is something called VS, which is secondary wave velocity, and VP, the primary wave velocity. Only thing is I should know what is VP and what is VS. If I am able to know these two, obviously I can get this distance D, that is distance. Okay. Once I get the distance, obviously I can plot a curve and find out that. For example, if the point is very near, obviously the distance between P and S will be very small, very, very small. That means the time difference between TP to TS is a very small affair. Suppose if you are keeping your instrumentation too long, that means the distance between time between TP and TS is large. When the time between P and S is large, that means it is far away. So this is scientifically proven, and there is because of the expression is given, you can always compute what is the D. But we should clearly identify the arrival of P wave time and arrival of S wave time and arrival of L. These are all we should arrive. We can easily arrive. That is why I'm showing the peak record. So the next point is, suppose I measure at a particular point here and then make a circle whose radius is D. That D we computed from that expression. So I get a circle. That means the epicenter is well within the circle. So if I want to get narrowed down, I need minimum of 3 circles. Certainly today's technology is so that we have so many equipments, hundreds of equipments, and we have hundreds of data. We can have very narrow result. But this what you're seeing is purely for demonstration for the student or any faculty to understand the concept. That is why I am taking only 3. So wherever the 3 point made, that is what is called epicenter. So this is a simple expression. This is how we tell the simple model of how we do it. Suppose instead of 3, suppose I have 100 points in this area, United States and Canada, if I have 100 points. So I can have a very fine way of reaching it. So the question is, it depends on the error. Let me say that with the 3 circle, I am able to locate, there may be an error of say 100 meters or 200 meters or 500 meters, depending upon what our situation it is. But as I go on increasing this number of circles, and maybe having hundreds of data, the error will be less than 0.5 meter or even 0.1 meter. So this is the way that we arrive at epicenter location. That is how, if you see in paper, sometime next day also they correct that. So coming to understanding VP, which is nothing but elastic material, E by rho, like that only. So this is the expression for velocity of P wave. This is the expression for velocity of S wave, where mu is something like G, shear modulus of material, rho is the density. So this is Young's modulus, bulk modulus, all that. So elastic modulus by rho. Rho, this is a simple expression that you know. This expression is assuming that the wave propagation as a unidimensional way. Really speaking, it's a solid three-dimensional wave propagation to exist. But here we assume the single directional pass possibility and then try to get this. So it is still, this is an acceptable fact, just to know that. So coming to the next, that is the basic introduction of what is earth and how the earthquake comes. So now I am going to little further to tell you how dynamics is very important in earthquake. So for example, to demonstrate this, I am going to show this bridge, which is Takamanara bridge. Every one of you is aware. It failed on November 7, 1940. What really happened was the amplitude of oscillation of the midspan reached nearly 14 feet. The amplitude of vibration has gone to 14 feet. When absolutely there is no load at all. Only there was a wind flowing. Wind is supposed to flow horizontal direction. It can blow above the bridge. It can blow below the bridge also. There is enough space to go there, do like that. But however, the tilting is such, actually there is a torsion also. The tilting is such at the center span, the maximum amplitude it reached was nearly 14 feet with absolutely no load in it. So this is the special phenomena which is special on dynamics. This can be explained like this. Suppose this is a bridge that you are seeing in a dark circle. So let me say that is a bridge. So when the wind flows, the wind blows above the bridge as well as below the bridge. So it can have a smooth flow and there is no problem. Obviously, there will be some load for which the bridge is designed. Let me say like that. But however, there is something called vortex shedding, which is a special phenomenon, which happens and then creates a trouble where the bridge is vibrating vertically up or vertically down, as the case may be. So this is the special situation, what is called vortex shedding. That means the wind is flowing horizontally, but the bridge is vibrating vertically. So this is a special phenomenon which really happens only when the velocity of wind is exactly matching with the natural frequency of this body. So this is a very peculiar phenomenon. I want you to know this. So this is a very, this kind of problem is going to be an earthquake also. But demonstration wise, I am taking this for a wind case. So that is how this this bridge went up in, even though there is no load on that, the amplitude of vibration was nearly 14 feet, which is not acceptable level, and simply it failed, and that is what every one of us know. So very similar to that, dynamics is important in case of wind as well as earthquake, and to explain certain failures. For example, let us take this building. So this building is a nearly about 11-story or 12-story building, where you are seeing 12 slabs here, one above the other. So this, all columns failed, and then the slabs came as a pack of cards. So this is a very special situation. And how do you explain this? So this is an RCC building. Obviously, it is designed for some dead load, live load, and some earthquake load also. But there are certain phenomena which is really unexplainable in real term, which is due to dynamics. And then that create more trouble than normal. We will see all this, how it is. And then it simply fails. Same way in a cyclone, you can get this kind of towers feeling peeling off. This is in our near Chennai only. So there are so many things that are near happening in our country or outside based on certain concepts. For example, how do you explain this building? This happened in Japan, where this building is intact for all these floors, or it is intact above these floors also. There is one floor that is gone. So you may say that that is a weak floor like that, but there is nothing like weak or something like that. These are all the phenomena which is very special in understanding dynamic part of it, and then create a new understanding that is needed so that the building finally stands without any issue. So in order to understand that, I want you to introduce two interesting things. So every building or object has something called frequencies at which it likes to vibrate. So because I'll come to that way it likes to vibrate. So that is what we call natural frequency. Similarly, it will also take a shape. It takes a characteristic geometry. For example, a vertical building will slide like this. That is the way it is. So what I'm trying to say is, given a fact that either a building or bridge for all the dimensions and material properties are known to me, I can find out what is this natural frequency and what is this mode shape. I can easily find out. So these two are very important thing for further processing. Okay, I am not going deep into it, but centrally I introduce what is this. For example, if I have to model this building for a dynamic understanding, the first thing that comes into our mind is the inertia. The inertia is nothing but mass into acceleration. Mass means it is nothing but the dead weight of the building divided by g. Of course, there is part of live load also can come, but let us take for the time being dead load only. So the dead load becomes Baiji is called MAS, and MAS is going to be creating for inertia. That is the way it is. The second part is the deformability. Suppose I have a building, let me say I have a 10-story building, and I apply a 10 kilonewton of force at the top of the building, and the building deforms at the top to a tune of 10 mm. So that means 10 kilonewton by 10 mm is the stiffness. So this is what is called deformability, how the deformation capacity in the building is there. So this we call that as elasticity or stiffness, as the case may be. That is why we give the spring as the representation. That means if I apply a load in the horizontal direction, because earthquake or wind is a horizontal affair, lateral affair, so we talk like that. Doesn't mean that vertical it will happen, the other vertical also it can happen. So this is the two things that you need to know. Of course, there is something called energy dissipation. We'll come a little later. So this is, suppose if I have structure and I apply a load, and I know the deformation, load by deformation is what your K is. So the basic definition is force is equal to stiffness into displacement. So this is anyhow you taught PU in synthetic materials. But of course, this may be a static problem as such. So that is first thing I need to know. The second thing is, there is possibly an addition that is possible, which is called, which is explained in terms of energy dissipation. What is energy dissipation? Suppose there is an earthquake on a building which is 10-story building, and the earthquake lasts for 40 seconds. Let us say like that. So for the 40 seconds, the building is going to vibrate left, right, the way earthquake comes. That is fine. But at the end of the 40 seconds, it should come to stop 100%. But that will not happen. What really happens is, it takes few more seconds, let me say 2 seconds or 5 seconds, to come from the maximum vibration to zero. This is the way it is. This is what we call free vibration. So the way in which the free vibration happens and the time it takes for this, for coming to zero, so that is indirectly telling us there is some kind of energy dissipation capacity in a building. What is that? We don't know. Let me say, no issue. Because once I say it is mass, it is nothing but weight by G. Once I say stiffness, it is lateral load divided by lateral deformation. But what is the energy dissipation, if you ask me? So it is an indirect measurement of how the vibration comes down to zero from wherever it was. That is the way it is. So it is not going to take big time. So it may take only few seconds, or maybe less than a second also possible. It all depends on the damping quality. So this is the three things I should know. So if I have a, let me say I have a 10-story building, I put all the weight divided by G, I call this M, I put it at the top, and then I have the deformation capacity as stiffness and keep it as K, and the damping, let me say I don't know for the time being, let me say C, I don't know for the time being is C. So it is called MKC system. It is called MKC system. This is how you model a building or bridge, whichever you call, you can simply model them like that. That is the first thing I want you to know. Then you will ask, what is this use of this? So you will ask a question like that. It is okay, but we can find out something called natural frequency from this. So I am not going to derive that, but it is nothing but root K by M. Omega equal to root K by M. So that is the way it is. Or if you are looking for F, it is 1 by 2 pi into root K by M. So from this property of K and M, I am able to get the natural frequency. So demolition response also you can get using C. I am not going to all this expression because it may be boring to you. But this is a first phenomena I want you to understand that. The second is the resonance, which is happening. Suppose if the disturbing frequency and the natural frequency are matching, like what you have seen in the Takamanero bridge, something called resonance can happen. Obviously, at the point of resonance, the vibration amplitude is going to be larger. That is what happened in the Takamanero bridge. That is why it failed. So this is a very interesting part that we need to worry about. This is the same thing that we need to understand a little better. So in order to demonstrate that, I would like to demonstrate this using a kind of simple washing machine. Washing machine is a peculiar object which I can model this as my MKA system. Let us assume that I can find out the mass, I can find out the stiffness, I can find out the damping. Forget about that, how to get that, all that I get it. Let me say I got that, but how do I explain this washing machine? Washing machine is having cloth, wet cloth revolving around. So that is, if the mass of the cloth is M and it is at the eccentricity of E from the center, and it is rotating at a radius second speed of omega, that means the force is me omega square. That's all. So that is a force that is acting in this model with m k c like that. So obviously this way I took this washing machine is so peculiar an object where the speed is varying continuously and it is not going to rotate at a single frequency. So suppose, let me say, using fuzzy logic, people, they put logic control inside. So it moves in various speeds. So one of the time it will come across resonance. There is no other way you can avoid that. So this is a very peculiar situation. Okay, how do, suppose assuming that there is a vibration that happens, how to avoid that? Of course, how to avoid that, there are more than one solution, but I am going to demonstrate only one solution just to have some idea of what is this. So what I do is I introduce one more absorption, one more system. Let me say it is 1/10 of this. Suppose this is the mass of the building. I say 1/10 of the mass I keep. Similarly, this is K. Suppose I keep 1/10 of K here. This is C. I keep 1/10 of C here. So I create a secondary system within the washing machine, which is within the washing machine. I connect to the washing machine main mass. I do that. So what really happens is this is called the primary system and this is called secondary system. This is called secondary system. So suppose there is a vibration that comes, mu omega square force that comes. There are two systems to take care. This is a strong system. This is a weak system. That is not the correct word, but I am still using just to make you feel what it is. So this is the two things are available. So what really happens is energy is going to flow here only. The secondary system will experience large vibration. The primary system will experience less vibration. That means if I am able to divert 90% of the energy to the secondary system, 10% will still come because we cannot avoid 100% solution to any problem. So, but this may be very small. 10% means it may be very small. You may not feel that and it is not creating any trouble. So this is a concept which is called tuned mass damper. So this, like this, there are umpteen number of concepts. Don't you should not imagine that there is only one concept like that. So there are so many things that is possible. This is what is done to eliminate the motion in the object. This is called secondary system, also called tuned mass damper. This is the first thing I want you to know. So how it is useful as civil engineering? The best example that I can quote you is Taipei 101 Tower. Taipei 101 Tower is a 101-story building available in Taiwan. It is available Taipei, a town called Taipei. So this is a 100-story reinforced concrete building. As you can see the elevation here, what they have done is this natural period of the building is roughly, not exactly, okay, roughly it is about 10 seconds. The natural period is about 10 seconds for this building. What these guys have done is they have created a pendulum, a simple pendulum at the top of the building around 94th floor or something. At the 94th floor, they hung a small pendulum within this block, whose natural period is exactly 10 seconds. So this is where we use TMD in real life. So there are many examples I can quote, but however, I choose to tell you one simple thing like what you are seeing here, which is a very good example in my personal opinion. So this is the real picture of a symbolic representation of how the pendulum looks and how the rod. This is actually wire kind of thing, iron wire. There are four wires that comes, so it connects, and with this region, it should be free. Because it has to move in all direction possible. We don't know which direction earthquake comes or wind comes. So we should leave equal space all around. So the pendulum has to move here and there when there is a disturbance. If there is no disturbance, this is not going to move. So that is the way it is. This is a realistic photo of that pendulum. You can see this. This is for the completed assembly of the tuned mass damper. So these people are standing here so that you can understand what is the dimension look like. So this is the weight of the plumb and there are four wires that are going at four places. So this is a tuned mass damper. So we are able to understand that the Taipei 101 Tower has introduced this kind of concept, tuned mass damper concept, wherein the building, in case if it is subject to either wind or an earthquake, which is supposed to be a lateral force affair, since the main system is also 10 second period and the secondary system also 10 second period, so the pendulum will vibrate little here and there. Of course, you know it will have a constant amplitude, it will go left and right. That is no problem. But the energy will be flowing here and only 10 to 15% of the energy will go to the structure for which it is capable of. Any structure would have been capable of taking certain lateral forces. So that is not a problem. So this is the first thing I want you to note. So I'm not going to derive anything. Simply to say that for the dynamic equation looks like this, wherein the mass into acceleration is the inertial force. We have seen already U double dot is a mass thing. So that means the mass into acceleration is the force. Similarly, stiffness into displacement is a force. These two are well known to you. Only thing is the damping is a little confusing, as I told you, because it is not definitely getting a number. So that is proportional to velocity we take. And then we say if the U is the motion, that is displacement. So into K, that is stiffness, that is one force. This may be static also. And this mass into acceleration is a force, damping into velocity is a force. So there are three kind of forces which we can equate and to the dynamic force that is coming into earthquake, where F of T is, in our example, we say it is an earthquake. So this is how the first and second mode would look like. Suppose this is the first mode, this is a building, and this the first mode will look like this. That means the all floor will go one side all the time. So coming to the second mode, suppose the first floor goes left, the second floor goes right, like that. So this is the way it is. Certain portion will go left and certain floors go right. Whereas in the third mode, first floor goes left, then this is right, the third is right, like that, left like that. So this is that means I can say that first mode will not have any zero crossing of the center line, second mode will have one crossing, third mode will have two crossing, like that. So we can identify all this, how this is going to move, all that it is very clearly known. Once you get the building into a software like SAP or something, you will immediately get all this. So coming to the loading part, so loading part is earthquake is assumed to be a load. So please understand that. Honestly speaking, earthquake is not a load. That we will come a little later about that. However, earthquake is a load is what our 1893 talks about. So that means how to get the load. Okay, that is an important thing. So the load is obtained as, so let me say mass into acceleration is a force. So that is what Newton said. So one other thing that you need to get from this is acceleration. That is one thing that we need to know. But interestingly, if you see the earthquake that you're seeing in various things, they neither have same duration nor have same amplitude. So, and also the peak to peak time that it takes between two peaks are also not same. So it is a very funny situation wherein there is a high randomness here in terms of acceleration value, in terms of time period value, in terms of duration value. Any value that you take, they are all random. There is no definite curve it is here. How are we going to get the force for various earthquake like this is what is called the concept of response spectrum. So for any building, for example, as I said, any building, I can immediately model that as MKC system and find out the natural period. Okay, let me say T. Okay, let me say T is 0.1. So I give an earthquake at the bottom and find out the response at the top. Okay, this is what is called response spectrum. How it is plotted, I will briefly explain to you. For example, let me take as an example, I will take El Centro earthquake 1940. So the top one black color you see, what you see is an acceleration plot. The blue color what you see is a velocity plot. And the red color what you see is displacement plot. So this is the same earthquake, but it can be seen in terms of acceleration. Or if you integrate it into, you can see this as velocity. If you integrate once more, you get as displacement. All are very important, but this is what is explained as ground motion. Once you get the ground motion, I have a simple degree of freedom system for which I know I have an equation like m mass into acceleration, c into velocity, k into displacement is equal to minus mu ug is ground acceleration. That is what we have seen in the previous curve. So this is the ground acceleration. So the ground acceleration I can give here, where mass is the same mass that the building that is moving. So anything above the ground only we normally take as a mass. The issue here is if the bottom slab is exactly moving as a top slab without any UR, suppose UR is zero, there is no issue at all. Which will not happen because all our buildings are flexible. There is something called relative displacement that has to happen. That is the way it is. Suppose let me say this UR is zero. That means the whole building is moving as a rigid body. Nothing happens. You don't need to go any further. But we do not have any building in under the earth like this. So obviously there is something deforms. Once it deforms, so I have this force due to inertia, due to damping force, due to stiffness. I have all these force. And the earthquake force is nothing but mass into that ground acceleration, in which I know this UG, I know, because this is the data that is available. Mass I know, K I know, C I know, everything I know. Only thing is I do not know what is UR. I do not know what is UR dot, what UR double dot, all these things I don't know. So this is the first thing I want you to know this. So of course I don't want to go into derivation, but if you do some kind of simple derivation like divide by M and find out what is C by M, what is K by M, all that. K by M is nothing but omega square, C by M is equal to 2 psi omega. So forget about it. I am not deriving anything, but I want you to see here. The equation here is UR double dot 2 psi omega UR plus omega square UR equal to minus U dot GT. In this equation, this is a left hand is given only acceleration. So that is readily available. Your El Centro earthquake you can take. This is simply available. Your omega is available. It is nothing but K by M. Your psi is available. It is a damping ratio. I will come to that later. Omega is a natural frequency. So I know everything. What I need to know is I don't know UR. I don't know UR dot. I don't know UR double dot. So these are all the three things that we need to know. We need to get. So obviously this is a second order differential equation, simple ordinary differential equation. Obviously there is a solution. What is solution? You can integrate them. So I can integrate twice and get UR as simple as that. I can integrate twice. Of course, you know the Newmark method is used. Of course, you if you don't know that, at least you know the central difference method somewhere you have been taught. So there are a variety of methods in which you can integrate. So I can integrate twice and get the UR. So that is the way it is. So coming to understand that, suppose this is the El Centro earthquake, and in this equation, please note there are only two things that are not known. That is T equal to 2 pi by omega. That is T is a natural period. So let me say T is a natural period of the building. So T is one thing. Psi is damping, which we don't know. So these are all the two things. For example, if I have a building, I don't know what, I know what is the natural period. So okay, let me now say there are hundreds of buildings in the whole globe whose natural period can vary from 0.1 to 10. Let me say like that. So I take this exercise. I assume psi equal to 0.5. 0.5, actually concrete is having 0.07. So that is why steel is having 0.2 like that. So psi, I assume that 0.5, because now I'm standardizing, forgetting about steel or concrete or something. So psi equal to 0.5, I assume. T equal to 0.1, I assume. Go back to the equation, integrate twice, I get U. That means I get a time history as what you see here. In this time history, which is called response of the single degree freedom system, for which natural period is 0.1, the damping is 0.5. That is 5%. We call that 5% damping. So in this curve, which is coming out of the software by double integrating the above equation, I am selecting a point which is peak. The peak may be positive, may be negative. Doesn't matter to us. We are interested only in absolute acceleration. We are not interested in positive negative. There is nothing positive negative here because the building moves left and right. Positive negative are only indication. So absolute maximum I take, I simply plot. So let me say at 0.1 second, the acceleration is whatever the number I get, I plot. Clear? Same way I go to the next point. Now I say same 0.5, T is 0.2. I get a different output. I get a different answer. I plot the second point. I go on like that, third point, 0.3. 0.4, 0.5. Like that, I go on plotting and get a full curve. That means this is going to tell me, the x-axis is going to give me 0 to 4 seconds. That means roughly is about up to 40-story building, everything is covered. I am roughly saying, don't go by that. If your natural period of the building is 4, you have to go here. If the natural building is 1, you have to go here, like that. But interestingly, the problem is, now we ended up in a displacement. But displacement is okay. You can understand how much the building deforms. That is okay. But our idea was to get the force. Force needs acceleration. How to get from displacement to acceleration? So that is very simple. There is something called pseudo velocity, which means omega into d. The previous curve, you simply multiply all d ordinates with omega at each point. But you multiply that. So you multiply that, you get this curve. So this is what is called pseudo velocity curve. So this is, now you have come to velocity than displacement, it's slightly better. And really speaking, we need acceleration. That means I have to again do it one more time. It is omega square d. So the displacement curve, if I multiply every ordinate with omega square, I get this. Because I am using some pseudo expression, which is normally used in the harmonic vibration theory. So I am using the word P, pseudo acceleration like that, PSA. Pseudo spectral acceleration like that we use. So this is the thing that we get. So now I get acceleration. So now I am happy. So if I know the mass of the building, and suppose my natural period is 1, let me say 10 story building, the natural period is 1, and I come here and find out the acceleration is 200, and my mass is say 10,000. 10,000 into 200 is the force, horizontal force that is going to happen. So this is as simple as that. This is what is response spectrum. So this is good. But the problem is we have considered only one earthquake called El Centro. That is the first point I wanted to note. The second point I wanted to note is the curve is not so smooth, it is so funny. How to give in a code? Because finally the aim is to give it in a code. So let us see one by one. So the second point I wanted to note is because we solved the problem for 5%, we should also solve the problem for 0%, 10%, 20% like that. Why they have not solved above 20%? Because it is not normally possible to have a structure which is above 20% unless you put dampers there. So this is the way it is. What the message here is, for if the damping is very high, the acceleration, the displacement is very low. That is the first message. If the damping is zero, the displacement is very large. So that is the way it is. So damping plays a role. So once I know the material damping, I can use that accordingly. So this is the first message I want you to note. The second message I want you to note is the same thing is seen in acceleration mode. Finally, this is what we are looking for. So we are looking for in acceleration mode, and we are able to get 0 second, and for various damping, I am able to get. What is the problem here? The problem is the curve is so funny that I am not able to understand many things, and I am not able to take it to code. formula or something like that. And I also want to note that the variation in this region, peak region, is so funny. Suddenly it increases or suddenly it increases. Suppose I average it out, it is okay, but I will lose important things like this. I wanted to note this because people think that code is God like that. That is okay. So to come out of this, there is something called Fourier plot of thing. So something called displacement we got, something called pseudo velocity we got, something called acceleration we got for the same data only. There only is different forms. So I plot the horizontal axis as pseudo velocity and the inclined red axis as acceleration, inclined green axis as displacement, plot all three datas in one. Now it looks slightly better. So there is a drooping here and there is more or less average out here and there is another drooping at the third point. So this looks slightly better. Now the problem is you are solving only for L syndrome, but the earthquake can happen in so many possibilities. So the same thing with the four-way plot for various damping we have seen. So this is good. So let us go to the other issue. The other issue is it is not L syndrome. There are hundreds of earthquakes that can happen. So I try to take more number of earthquakes. Let me say now in this example, there are 5 earthquakes that are shown. If I plot 5 earthquakes, see I also show a red line, which is average of all this. So I have 5 earthquakes plotted the response spectrum and I take the average line, which is red line. If you watch red line, it looks very interesting because there is an increase from here to here. And there is a horizontal line from here to here, and there is a drooping line. But this is, please understand, this is a log-log plot, 100% log-log plot. So then anyhow, this is a simple thing to happen. So now it emerges slightly better. So I am able to do things better. So what I have to do is, I need to do some kind of mathematics, okay? Mathematics, statistics, phenomena, hundreds of earthquake I take, and then try to do some kind of statistical method to arrive at this kind of segments. Let me say I arrive at segments, various segments. And this is what done by Neumark Hall in long back, which they called them at elastic spectrum. So finally, it comes down to three parts. The one is a straight line, which is straight line. Then it is a horizontal line. Then there is a drooping line. Actually, this curve shows 4 parts. Indian curve shows only 3 parts. Doesn't matter. So there are only 3 parts that are available, which is a curve between spectral acceleration and period. Now we brought into... After studying there, we brought into linear theory, linear form, not in a log-log form. Because finally, we want to give this into code. Having arrived that, there are certain issues I want you to note. For example, if you see this Mexico, even though average out is taken out, if you see Mexico earthquake alone, at certain period between 2 to 3, there is large displacement that is visible. That is why that is a problem in Mexico. This means the building between 20 stories to 30 stories, let me say around 25 stories, are experiencing large displacement, which is a dangerous scene in Mexico. Really, it happened like that. Only certain building of those height only fell in Mexico. The building less than 15 stories or more than 30 stories didn't experience anything. So this is one phenomena I want you to note in cases which are very special, something like that. If you do the same thing in acceleration mode, it is totally different. See, still Mexico remains the same at this different period level. All of the things come at some other place. So obviously we need to worry about average spectrum. Sometime helps, sometime it is better. Like city of Mexico cannot follow anything like that. So they need to have separate code and then understand this totally different phenomena. So this also we should note. So there is something called localized understanding of the earthquake response spectrum and the global thing what is given in 1883. So finally, coming to 1883, this is what you see in 1883, which says that there is an increase here and there is 2.5 as the maximum peak that is going to have and 3 curves depending upon soft soil. Soil also is taken into account. Soft soil, medium soil and hard soil as the case may be. So accordingly, this curve is given. Depending upon damping ratio, you need a factor. Suppose you are 5%, concrete is 7%. That means you have to multiply the values by 0.9. That is the way it is. So you can get this curve and into nice. See, this is how the response spectrum is arrived in decode. So finally, what you are getting is this. Get this. This is good. There is nothing wrong in that. But there are issues wherever this 2.5 is happening. Possibly there is a variation that can happen. That is one thing. And the way in which we have keep medium soil or rock, whatever, there is some difference can exist. So 100% we go by theory is okay, but there is some variation that is possible is also, you should know that. So that is the second point I want you to note actually. So from here, of course, the force is nothing but the shear, base shear is nothing but, there is an expression that is given in the code, which is nothing but SA by G into I by R. into the, this. This is the way that code gives these values. Suppose your building in natural period is 0.5, that is 5-story building. You go here and find out 2.5. 2.5 will be SABG. I is impact factor, R is the reduction factor. And all that you can multiply and get the base shear force the way that you want. So that is the first thing that anyhow some we can see later about the course material later. So we will skip that and go to some other things that I want you to highlight. Okay, what are all the other things that I need to know as far as earthquake is concerned so that my buildings experience during an earthquake? One such thing is, let me say that in a frame, there is a column. In a frame, there is a column. Let me say in that column, there is a Bendingham diagram, you know that. So what happens is, the Bendingham diagram is such that the Bendingham at the top is supposed to be larger and very similar to the bottom. They need not be equal. They can be unequal also. That is one thing. And the in between the portion, the Bendingham is not that good, that big. So this is the first thing I want to note. Let me say you are designing a multi-story frame subjected to lateral load in which you consider dead load, live load, and the earthquake load. So when you get finally a Bendingham diagram on combination of all this, a typical figure will be like this. That means it. What the message here is, if there is a column in the frame, okay, the top portion of the column is going to experience maximum bending moment. The bottom portion of the column also likely to have maximum bending moment. In between, it is not a serious problem. Bending moment will be there, but it is not that serious. This is the first point I want you to note. The second point I want you to note is, because of that, when an earthquake comes, the maximum bending moment region only gets away, because the bending moment due to lateral forces is going to create large bending, especially in the ground floor, it is going to be serious. So the maximum bending moment is going to be there. At this point, because the bending moment exceeded, obviously it is not able to sustain the capacity, the bending moment capacity and demand is not matching. So it fails. So this is what is called column failure. So at the top. So this is the first thing I want you to note, because this is one thing that we need to understand in terms of understanding how a building frame works. Interestingly, what is happening here is, in addition to lateral force, there is a heavy axial force. Please understand that. Because of the heavy axial force that is there, suppose this is the ground floor column and there are about 8 floors above. So there is heavy axial force. Because of the axial force, the bending moment capacity will be reduced because of the P&M action. So that is also there. So obviously the capacity will be much reduced at this place. So during an earthquake, this force is going to be coming like this. And then there is a deformation of this column that happens. So this deformation is going to create trouble and create some additional bending moment. The additional bending moment is going to be again at the top and bottom only. So that is why the column fails at the top or the bottom. So this is the one understanding. So if I know this phenomena, so I need to keep this kind of section to be larger than the bending moment that is going to come. It's a very important thing I want you to note. So that is a very important thing that I want you to note. Mainly because if we go back to this curve, what is the force is nothing but this mass into acceleration. This is the force that we are getting into I by R, because impedance factor and R reduction factor and Z by 2. So everything is very clear. Z is known because that is a zone. Zone is if you are in zone 4, 0.36 like that. So you know that 0.36, 0.24, 0.1, all that you have. So for a given thing, I know what is Z, what is everything I know. So Z by 2, I by R, SA by G. So I simply multiply every one of them into the dead weight, total weight of the building, that is going to be the lateral forces. Now, because of the issue here is, we are doing this 2R at the bottom. 2R at the bottom is there. So that means you are trying to reduce the forces, which is what is really coming. That is where it is. Let me say for a special moment resisting frame, R equal to 5. Let me say 2R is 10. That means you are designing for 1/10 of the force that is likely to come. Please understand that. So you have designed and everything is fine. So what is happening here is, the force is going to come, earthquake force alone is going to be approximately 10 times or at least 5 times higher than what you have computed from the code. So that is going to come. So what is the provision that you have here? Because if you have the normal section that that is likely to be there, and this bending moment is going to be, earthquake alone is going to be multiplied by 10 times or 5 times as the case may be. So this is a serious problem where the bending moment comes at the top. Obviously, this is a failure zone. I know this. So I a priori know that how the column is going to fail. So I need to worry about this and do something about this. So if only I make something at the top and bottom of this, we can come out of this. That is the way it is. So we need to understand this part of failure. and for which only there is a kind of concept, that is what is called strong column weak beam concept. So what really happens is, if you want to have larger ductility in your building, that is large deformation capacity in your building, and you don't want the column to fail, that is the thing. So the question is, because we know that the bending moment diagram is going to be there, again top and bottom is going to be larger, and the failure is going to be at the top and bottom only, that also we know. So obviously, we have, for example, the one building that I shown here, one of the floor fails. So this is the way that hinges form at these two places, and the bending moment it fails. That means if this happens, anyhow the building is no more useful to us. The same way somewhere here happens, or the same way something. So this is a serious problem. So one way that we can come out of this, suppose you want to come out of this, because the realistic force that is come is much larger than what is given in the code. The one way of coming out is make your column stronger, and the corresponding beam weaker. It's a comparative statement, doesn't mean that your beam is weaker like that. So what really happens is, when the maximum bending moment comes, and it is because every column is connected, well connected to the beam, and the hinge, for if there is a weak link here, the beam get higher bending moment there. So that means it is likely to rotate more and then create a kind of hinges. We will come to that. So that means, let me say that I have a mechanism in which all beams has hinges, all columns do not have hinges. Like that, if I have, then this problem is solved. So this kind of problem where this column top is, this is the first attempt. Of course, there is second attempt I will come to a little later. So this is the first attempt in which I can make this column stronger everywhere, not only here, the ground floor or first floor, everywhere I can make the column stronger. So one of the ACA 318 says the strong column weak theory. How do I understand strong column weak beam theory? It says the sum of column strength exceeds the sum of beam strength at each beam column connection by 1.2 times. So this is ACA 318 codes. There are many other references up to 1.4 they are saying. So I have taken ACA 318 just for comparison of something. That's all. Something we have to compare. So for example, if I have at a particular joint, if I have two columns here and there, for example, like this, if there is a column and there are two beams that are there, if there is a column and the beam connected there, and the column bending moment top and column bending moment bottom is added, should be greater than 1.2 times Mn plus Mn minus of beam. So what are we talking about here? This is about capacity. Let me say you have designed a beam. That means you have designed a beam for which you know the width and you know the depth. B and D is known. Clear? And you also know what is the AST and what is the AAC, because this building is already designed. Let me say like that, because we are only trying to find out what is happening to the building when the earthquake comes. So having that is what is called capacity. For example, how do you design beam? It is M by FCK BD square like that. Now in this case, you know everything except M. AST is known, everything is known, except M is not known. So you find out that M, that is what is called capacity of the beam. So capacity of the beam and left and right, you add them. And the similarly, top and bottom of the column moment capacity also, you know, because it is going to be P and M interaction. It is not straight away moment. So from that also, you can find out. You can use SP16 only and find out all this for a given section. So you find out this, and these two should be 1.2 times larger than these two. This is how we define roughly a strong column weak beam concept. So if you go by this, obviously you are supposed to revise the, suppose if it is not matching like that, you are supposed to revise the column section as well as column reinforcement. So this is one way in which we try to, not the only way, we'll come to that little later. So that if you don't do that, it will be like this. It will be like failure like this, because columns are subjected to peculiar bending moment scene, and it will fail like this. The strong column weak beam concept is a very important thing that you have to follow in the design of the section, as the case may be. So another thing that I want to do, the second point I want you to understand, is something called short column effect. The question is, suppose I have a column of length L. Let me say I have a column of length L. What is the stiffness of the column for this to deform it, delta? What is the force I have to apply? It is going to be 12A by L cube. You know that stiffness, horizontal stiffness is 12A by L cube. So let me say the L is 3 meters. Okay, L is 3 meters. So all other parameters are known to me. So I say 12A by L cube is the stiffness. So the delta is depending upon the 12A by L cube. Suddenly, suppose I cover 3/4 of the column by a wall. Let me say like that. in some place for some reason. That is what is called short column effect. That means that because it is covered with the masonry wall up to 2/3, the effective length of the column becomes suddenly 1/3. That means if you use the same formula of 12a by L cube, L become 1/3 L. That means the stiffness is becoming 21 times higher than this. That means, really speaking, it is stiffer. Please understand that, stiffer. The strong column becomes suddenly stiffer compared to the column which is 3 meters. So I just cover 2/3 of that distance, that is creating more trouble. That means the stiffer members will attract more force. So more force comes here, and since we don't have the capacity of the same 21 times force will come. That is the way it is. Please understand that. For the same given set of things, same given set of E and IL, everything same. If I cover 2/3 and leave 1/3, 21 times the force will increase. This is the way it is. So these are all the special things that we need to take care in terms of realistic. So if we, this is an example of this. So for example, this 1/3 of the length is kept for some kind of ventilation or whatever. So it is kept free. There is a wall that is coming here. Suddenly the length of column is becoming very low. So obviously this cannot sustain that kind of, this will happen only during earthquake. If the earthquake does not come, this failure is not going to happen. For dead load and live load, this will not happen. Please understand that. So this is a special effect of earthquake, which we need to understand the stiffness of the issue and then take it to further things. This is another kind of example. Suppose you have a multi-story building and in the ground floor, for some reason, you fill only 2/3 and 1/3 you leave it. These are all the places you will get failure, obviously. You can see here. You can see here. These are all the examples that are taken in this Bhuj region only. So you can see how this short column fails. So this is one simple theory. These are all simple things that we need to take care. See, I know that this is going to happen. Suppose if I close up to here and I'm leaving this length. So this is, we are learning only strength of materials, nothing greater than the resistance. Because it is only a question of stiffness and how stiff you are making it. And so stiffness plays a very important role. It is not a question of strength alone. Please understand that. That is what I am trying to say from the beginning. Earthquake is a different phenomena, ball game altogether. And we need to understand these things much better. So this is the second thing I want you to note. And similarly, if you have infill, that is another problem. See, infill, how it is taken, it is only a dead load for you. It is only a dead load for you. But only thing is, when it comes to lateral loads, vertical load, no problem. It may be a dead load only. But lateral load comes, there is a kind of resistance that can happen in the due to this infill. So unless you consider this also, you will not understand the dynamics of the phenomena. Or even stiffness. Let me say stiffness itself. Suppose this column is 12a by L cube, this column also 12a. But there is a band of wall that can come into effect. And that stiffness also you need to take into account. Some people take it as a truss like this. Doesn't matter. So whichever way you take, this stiffness of this infill wall is a very important thing to understand the dynamics of the building, and you are not supposed to leave it like that. Otherwise, you know, you have but the infill alone fails, doesn't matter. You can even replace them. That is not a problem. Let me say that is a secondary failure. But if the infill is going to create a new trouble and make your column fail, please understand that, like what you see here. That's all gone. If the column fails, the whole building comes down. In the same, you cannot repair it and then retrofit and then try to do something in the real life. So inflame wall, we need to understand much better than what we think that we are. It is nothing to do with the dead load that you are taking into account. So whatever the dead load that comes, I have taken. So this beam is supposed to take the load. Nothing to worry. It is not like that. It is because of the lateral load, the stiffness of the system can change and the effective stiffness of the column can change. Obviously, is it for better or the worse? We have no idea. So if it is for the worse, you are likely to lose the column. If you lose the column because the very principle of strong column, weak beam goes fat, and then you lose the column just like that. So this is another interesting thing that we need to worry about. Otherwise, we are likely to lose this. And suppose you lose this only and keep your column and beams are intact, then there is no problem. It is fine. There is nothing wrong in that. But we don't know what is going to happen. This is thing that we need to check. By taking the stiffness into account and try to say what happens to my column. Is it additionally becoming more stiffer or becoming less stiffer, whatever. So that we need to find out the force distribution that depending upon the stiffness distribution. And still you say that everything is safe. Yes, you can go ahead. Because certain failures you cannot avoid because the force is going to come, which is in real life is much more than what you compute. So there is something that can fail. For example, there may be a crack in the wall. which is only an infield masonry wall. It is not a serious problem. As long as there is no crack in all the beams and columns, you are still safe. That is okay. So that doesn't mean that you can design an infield like this. No, I am not saying that. I am just saying, in case if you take infill not that seriously, it is okay. That is the way it is. And the column, as I said about the short column effect, similarly, how do we connect these stairs? Because stairs also, if you take in terms of dead load and heavy load, you may be doing correctly and nothing will happen. Only when the motion starts, how the effective length of the column is getting affected, and then how this additional element is going to behave in the dynamic way, and suddenly it falls kind of thing. This is a peculiar situation wherein this is going to happen only when an earthquake comes. Suppose no earthquake comes, this is not going to happen at all. So that means we have designed for static loads, dead load and live load nicely. But when an earthquake comes, what will happen here, we have no idea. So that is not the way that we are supposed to design anything. So whether you take it as a global issue, as a whole frame, how it happens with the strong column weak beam theory, or you come to local connections, how do you want to connect the staircase, how do you want to connect the balconies, how do you want to connect, they are all very important. Of course, code is giving, it takes, you take the bending moment, which is 5 times like that, it is all saying. But that is again a rough idea of what is really happening. Suppose if I understand this kind of phenomena of short column effect, or the how the column additional stiffening is going to help, or I make some additional strengthening or stiffening or some kind of thing that we make before we go further, I can still save that. I can still save that. So this is a question of understanding of how do I plan the building. Similarly, about setbacks. Suppose I have 3 bays at the 2 floors. Suddenly, I make it to suddenly 1 bay. So if it is a regular building, that means if all goes, the uniform deformation will happen. So that is not a problem. So suppose this is delta, this is 2 delta, this is 3 delta, this is 4 delta, like that. Something like that, very similar to that. If it is linearly varying, I can take care of this. I can go ahead and then fine. But suddenly, if there are 4 columns to resist, that is 4 into 12a by L³. But here there are only 2 things, that is 2 into 12a by L³. That means the stiffness is becoming half of what is here. So obviously there is a kind of uneven distribution, and the deformation of this column is much larger than the corresponding column here. So this is some kind of unevenness that really happens. So this is what is called, we call that the vertical irregularity. But these are all the issues that we need to address as a special case, and redesign these columns totally different than these kind of columns. So that is the way that we need to take off irregularities. Because code, way we are talking about irregularities, whatever code gives is only for the regular building. The force distribution, let me say that force is distributed in the 4 floors the way that code says. You can go ahead. But can I do the same thing for this irregular building? Obviously not. Obviously not. And still you say that everything is fine. It need not. It need not at all. So there is a kind of re-understanding of what is given in code is only for this kind of regular building. Irregular building like this is not very much addressed in that. However, they warn you, please do dynamic analysis, please do that, this, like that, they warn you. And if you are not reading that particular line which warns you, that you are in trouble. So these are all the very important and simple things that can happen. And this is the building that I have shown in the initial thing, Kobe building. This is that kind of irregularity. Suddenly in 1 floor they have kept it open for various reasons. All other place they have some masonry wall, whatever. So that suddenly it becomes so it is a simple thing. As far as dead load and live load is concerned, nothing will happen. When an earthquake comes, there is suddenly in this floor the stiffness contribution is much less compared to the 1 floor above or ground floor above. Here also they say Indian code says 80% you should maintain. But are you doing it? If you do, it's good. But that is why it is. It is not the question. What I am trying to say is, just because I compute Z by 2, I by R into SA by G and say that is the force, and then design and everything is fine, it is not fine. Please understand that. Unless you understand the way in which the stiffness is distributed, how each floor is having the lateral resisting system, and if you don't understand that much, obviously failure will be like this. So this is how do you explain this otherwise? Because this also would have been designed with all the forces that do exist. Similarly, coming to the soft story. So when I was in Ahmedabad at the end of an earthquake, we find a lot of 10-story to 12-story building simply fell. You would have been aware of that. But even if you talk to a rickshawala, he says, sir, it is simple. If the building is soft, the ground floor open, it will fail. So this is what Rikshawala says. So that means it has become such a common parlance. But interestingly, there are other 100 buildings which is also having soft story. It did not fall. So we should not universalize theories like that. So that what I mean by that is soft story is a given necessity for anybody. So because car parking is there only. But only thing is I need to understand because I have the lateral resistance less with four columns only, whereas here there are four columns and three wall, there is a difference of stiffness between here and here, which the code says it should be 80% only can be allowed, or overall 70%, like something in the idea like that is allowed. So if you don't compute that, obviously this ground floor experiences large deformation like this compared to the next level, because this is less stiff, that is more stiff. So less stiff has more deformation, more stiff has less deformation. It is a very simple thing. There is no high tech here. So obviously, this additional deformation of delta is going to create additional bending moment, which is approximately equal to 60 by L square into delta. So that bending moment is going to happen in this column. That is the first thing. And suppose that is a bending moment at the top and there is another bending moment at the bottom. M plus M by L is the shear force. So these two are the additional funny things that are happening in a soft story only in the ground floor. Only in the ground floor. Suppose if I am taking care of this particular aspect of it, so how I make this column stiffer as equal to equal stiff as this? What four column and three walls stiffness is exactly equal to this four column stiffness. That's all, as simple as that. If you make it, this will not happen. This will not happen, as simple as that. So stiffness, how to make the stiffness better? It is not a question of strength. Please understand that. Most of the time, we think that strength is an important parameter. Strength is the important parameter until you design the building and get the reinforcement section, everything. No doubt on that. But once you get the building, and the building need not stand for an earthquake, is a very important point to probe. Then you feel that there is a problem here. So you understand there is a stiffness irregularity that happens here. So if this stiffness is improved, let me say the 12 by L cube, I cannot do anything about, because that is again 3 meter only. Only thing is I have to play something with E and I. E also I cannot play anything, because normally I use concrete of some kind of something. So there is no other way of changing a I value. It is as simple as that. It is as simple as that. So by playing with the value of I can increase this four stiffness, which is exactly equal to this four wall, four column and three wall stiffness, whatever be that. Exactly, because code allows 20% variation, but don't do that. You allow only 10% like that. So it is nothing wrong, because you want the building to be safe, because it has so many other repercussions. This is the one phenomena that you have understood, so you are correcting. There are so many other phenomena. For example, there is a shear force, which is nothing but M plus M by L. That is a shear force that will come at the top of the column. Do you have that? Check that. Check the shear capacity, whether it is having that. You will be surprised to know that it will not have. So these are all the issues that we need to know, that this is a very simple mechanics I am talking about. I am not talking about high tech area in this thing. Obviously, I don't want to show so many photographs, but you know that soft story fell in many places. Hundreds of photographs we have in various places, which includes Ahmedabad also. So this is another issue that we need to worry about. And stiffness irregularity can make, this is what we are talking about, pancaking. That is one slab above the other. The way in which the stiffness is distributed is not uniform. Means it will happen like this. So stiffness irregularity is a very important thing that one need to take care. And another thing is you should not have two buildings very near. You know that this is going to deform, because even code says not four times height. So it you know that how much it is going to deform. This also you know that, even assuming that everybody designed correctly, not that four times height, whatever. So that much distance you are supposed to give. Otherwise, this pounding effect happens. So these are all known fact, but still many places it is not a possibility. Another thing is this what is called a floating column. So they say one column, suddenly there is a slab that comes. The column is away from this. This is what is called indirect load path. This is in addition to stiffness problem, there is also a very complicated problem of this, because there is no load that is transferring from this column to this column. So this is normally done because in a multi-story building, 3 to 4 story building, in the ground, they want to have space like that. And once you go to first floor, they want this real estate people, they do this because they have more salable area that is better. That is okay, but structural engineering fails. That is a problem. So we need to worry about structural system which do not encounter this kind of thing. Why I am showing this is we have seen a lot of building like this. In this Bhuj area, if you see Ahmedabad, this building you see here, see there is a column here and there is a column here. How do this much offset if you give, you may prove as far the dead load and live load and even earthquake load, things may work as per the design calculation. And at the, when the fielding bails, you cannot come and say that I have designed as per 1883 and 456, why I should be relieved. Who said that? You are a structural engineer. You should know every principle of structural engineering. That's all. You are not a follower of code. This is a very important point I want you to note, because there are so many salient issues that are very relevant to earthquake engineering, which is relevant, and we are supposed to understand this kind of basic concepts. So if I don't know the concept, it is working. So I put in SAP 2000 or STAT Pro, and I applied 1883, and I applied hard dead load, live load with all factors, and everything was fine. Was fine, but is not now. It is fine. That is a problem. So there are a lot of misunderstanding in terms of how do I understand this motion as a phenomena in my building, depending upon the stiffness distribution, depending upon the mass distribution. If I don't understand that concept in terms of mechanics, which is basically not a big thing to think, that is a serious problem. So obviously the best way is you should have strong column and weak beam theory for a regular building. This is the way it is. So that means we ensure that the hinges, the maximum bending moment is going to come in the beam only, because something is going to come above the yield is a given fact. Please understand that. That's why I told many times that you are designing a building which is at, even if you take R equal to 3, that is 1/6 of realistic forces. 1/6 of realistic forces for OMRF building, 1/10 of realistic forces for SMRF building. So obviously there is a 10 times force is likely to come, or 6 times the force is likely to come, for which something has to yield. So the best way is you ensure that the beam yields. That is what AC, strong column weak beam theory. It is well explained in ACI 318, exclusively under topic of strong column and weak beam theory. And also any HRP guidelines are given clearly how to go about this. So if you go about that and then make this building better, nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. You can assure that your building is safe at the end of earthquake. Same way, this is another the way in which water tank is connected. See here, the water tank has fallen. That is because same short column effect. So you have a big mass here and the small two columns. See, in static, it will work, no issue at all. In static, all the loads are taken, this column is well designed, and it is going to perform better. When there is an earthquake, this is going to move left right. At that point of time, this column being a short column, if the stiffness is not sufficient, short column effect or vulnerable column, whatever you call them, it is going to fail. But compared to building failure, this is okay. You can at least replace them at the end of an earthquake. But the building itself fails is a very serious problem. So anyhow, this is another point I want you to note. So we have seen a lot of things in Ahmedabad region where this dislodging of water tank alone happens. So everybody has kept their water tank in the same funny way that what you have seen in the model. And most of the things fail. Especially in Mansi Tower, they had a swimming pool at the top of 12th floor. And the Mansi Tower failed, every one of you know maybe. So there are funny situations wherein there is a heavy mass of water that is being subjected to sloshing. And the sloshing frequency also can match with the natural frequency of the building, which can create additional trouble. We don't know if it has happened like that. I am just saying. So anything can happen like that. And it is the major problem why they were successful was they think that all the weight they have taken in the dead load. So they have designed the building accordingly. So everything is fine. So, but obviously nothing was fine. The whole Mansi Tower failed in Ahmedabad during the Bhuj earthquake. So this is, that is the all I wanted to say about this. Just to cross what is the way latest technologies, what are they happening? I just want to close with that. The future trends is they're talking about artificial intelligence in seismology. Because you know that artificial intelligence is a powerful tool that is going to be there. Because we have a lot of data in the seismic. So AI assists in identifying unknown features to more accurately predicting the earthquake activities. So AI in seismic analysis is now becoming a bigger thing in detecting small seismic events and also addressing the noisy data. So this is a great thing that is happening. And also AI helps based on the experience that we have in a particular place, we are able to predict the earthquake much better. Suppose Bhuj earthquake happened last time 2001, 50 years back something happened. In the last 200 days, 4 earthquake happened. Using the 4 earthquake, we are able to predict the full time history actually. So this is the kind of technologies that are being people talk about. And there is also something called seismic metamaterial. So there is some kind of electromagnetic metamaterial. This is actually wave physics. So because earthquake is nothing but a wave that is coming. So if the wave is coming and attacking a building, this is about elastodynamics or diffusion process. So they try to introduce some kind of material which is around the building. Suppose I keep something, you may know base isolation. That is a different concept, isolating the vibration itself. But here, the vibration is absorbed by using metamaterials within the soil itself. So they say that they are able to do tuned resonators buried in the soil. So if there is a motion, there are tuned resonators that are available within the soil, and they absorb, nothing will come to the building. So this is a kind of situation that is happening in the latest theories. So obviously, Rayleigh wave is the only thing that is what is called surface wave that only affects. So we know how it propagates. So if I don't have anything, the building is going to move like this. That is, no, we cannot do anything about it. In the first mode or second mode, it is going to move like that. But suppose if I introduce some kind of metamaterials, and having understood the motion, I introduce some kind of metamaterials, which is seismic wave absorbers. I keep all around the pile, and then all waves are absorbed there, and nothing comes to the pile. Then it is subject only dead load and live load, for which you already designed. Nothing is going to happen. So these are all the kind of research that are saying this is a kind of a metamaterial research. Even you keep a hole, a set of holes this guy has kept for a near a tower, and then try to find out what is the change that happens. You see the blue line and to red line, they are able to shift the frequency. Suppose my structure is having 10 seconds, and then a disturbing frequency also 10 seconds. So by using metamaterial, I can shift this. So nothing will happen to my building, because earthquake is some other frequency, my structure is some other frequency. So this is the kind of research that are going in metamaterials. It's very amazing. And multiple annual probability hazard map. We are, of course, you know that SCRC has created the hazard map, probabilities hazard map. We already have that. So this is going to the next level. They are going for multiple annual probability hazard map for various parts in India. Of course, India is divided into four zones, you know. But this is going still deeper, finding out how it happens in a given place. Suppose you give a place like Bangalore, that's all. In that, what happens like that? Localization and then microzonation or whatever you call them. So and also the analysis is also moving from static-based analysis to probabilistic design approach. Our performance-based design codes are evolving. You may be aware of this. So these are all the new design codes that are evolving depending upon performance, not based on loads, because the current code says based on loads. There is nothing wrong in that, but this is the way that things improves. So we are also thinking of new structural system and devices, like, you know, the passive energy dissipation systems or active energy dissipation system or base insulation, variety of things that are getting evolved. Analytical tool also getting better and better today. We are able to understand the nonlinearity. We are able to understand the strength distribution, stiffness distribution, and if stiffness degradation happens, how it is modeled, and the geometric effect. Geometric effect, it is the mode shape, you know, it is moving left, right, like that. That geometric effect, can I take into account? Soil structure interaction, can I take into account? So these are all the latest things that are happening in the this thing. I would like to thank you very much for the opportunity that is given to me.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your informative lecture. So through your lecture, we can understand your passion towards this particular subject. Now the forum is open for discussion. Participants, if you have any queries, we can allot some time for that. So if you have any questions, you please raise your hand and can unmute your mic, and you can just raise your questions.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I was having a question. There is no sign for raising the hand. Will I continue to ask?
Okay, no problem. You can just unmute yourself and you can raise the question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, sir. It was a very wonderful session. I'm having two doubts. Firstly, I wanted to know that how the damping that is present in multi-degree of freedom system can be calculated. In single degree of systems, we calculate the damping by using the logarithmic decrement. So in the same way, in case of multi-degree of freedom system, how the damping present in that system can be calculated?
Yes, there is a mathematical process. Basically, you know, we understand, for example, we civil engineers go by materials. For example, if I say a concrete building, it is going to be 7% of damping like that. And if it is a steel building, it is going to be 2% like that. So coming to your question, once I say that, if I am having reinforced concrete frame, let me say it is 7% like that, that is what code says. So we can take that, there's nothing wrong with that. from there, there is a mathematical expression in which you can convert it if you into the equivalent damping if it is a single freedom system, or distribute into multiple degree system. That is possible. Psi 1, psi 2, like that. Each model damping, that is, there is a procedure given in even Chopra book, it is there. So there is a process in which you can get all this. But for all this, please understand, the basic assumption is the 7% that you assume. That we cannot do anything about. Something we have to do, because that is the material damping. Assuming that the whole material damping that is available for a particular structure is taken as an input. That is an input that you have to take. From that, we can rework. There are expressions that is given in Chopra book also. You can say that model damping, if you want to convert it, you can convert it. For which the 7% forms the input. Similarly, in the steel building, it is going to be 2 to 3%. So that number we have to choose as the input to the whole problem. And from there, we can compute say, for model damping, first mode damping, second mode damping, or if you say multi-story models, that is also possible. That is already given in the Chopra, AK Chopra book, Structural Dynamics and Earthquake Engineering. This is a process that is available.
Yes, sir, I will refer the references given by you. One additional thing I wish to mention in that, I have studied one point named as Rayleigh damping. In that point, I have read that the damping present in the multi-degree of freedom system is directly proportional to the mass of the system and stiffness of the system.
That is what Newmark proposed. The same thing is given Chopra book also. Very good. You got the point. They say, see, strictly, let me say, talk in a colloquial way. Really speaking, when I say mass, I understand what is that. When I say stiffness, I understand what is that. But when I say damping, I do not understand the way that I understood mass and stiffness. So there is a vagueness. But only thing I know is it is proportional to velocity. That is the only thing that I know. So based on material, I try to arrive and say that concrete means 7%, steel means 3%. All that is over. Now, in order to make it a multi-model damping or as a multi-degree freedom system modeling, we need to rework. And at that time, I try to assume, because I have no idea, and I assume that it is possibly a percentage of mass and a percentage of stiffness. Let me say alpha m beta k. This is given in the Chopra book also. So how to get this alpha and beta, they have explained. For which you should assume that 7%. Somewhere you have to start, because there is no, without starting point, things cannot go. I can assume 7% as a material damping in the thing. Then I try to evaluate using some first mode value, get the alpha and beta. Once I get alpha and beta, then I know damping is equal to alpha times k plus beta times m. This is the way that is given in I am referring Chopra book, because I referred that there may be so many books that are available with this material, this model. Actually, this is done by Newmark and other people who to increase this way, and it is best explained in Chopra book. AK Chopra, University of California, Berkeley.
Yes, I was not confirmed about the answer, but now I am really confirmed with your explanation. One more thing I wanted to ask you, that in our presentation we somewhere talked about the resonance phenomena. Okay, The resonance phenomena is actually the phenomena when the natural frequency of the system matches with the forcing frequency. So in case of an earthquake, when an earthquake is a forcing is a force that is going to act on a building, then can there be a resonance phenomena?
First of all, earthquake is not a force. Let us accept that first. Okay. What is really happening is the ground is moving. That's all. It's as simple as that. So when the ground is moving, the building is likely to move because of the stiffness distribution system, whatever. Because the building moves, it has an acceleration, and that acceleration into mass is a force. So we are trying to derive that. That means force is an indirect phenomena compared to the motion that is really happening. That is the first point I want to note. The second point I want you to note is resonance means there is no force. At resonance, if you write the equation, if you write the AK Chopra book, first chapter itself, it is given. So if you write the equation, the force is equated to zero. Then only we say omega equal to root k by m. That means essentially to get the resonance, theoretically, please understand, theoretically, at the point of resonance, force is zero. this is theoretically, but really speaking, there may be some force slightly here and there, but it's a minor thing. If it is zero or very near to zero, also zero for me. Yes, that way. Okay. Now, given that resonance is one phenomena where natural frequency is exactly equal to the disturbing frequency. For example, the typical example that I can again all the time quote is Mexico earthquake. Mexico earthquake. There are more than 5-6 records that happened in the last 200 years. Every time the period of the earthquake is always 2 seconds and 2.5 seconds, like that. That is the variation. So that means 2 seconds will affect 20-story building. 2.5 seconds will affect 25-story building. So except 20 to 25-story building, all other building will survive. It is for sure because the input is very clear. That is, it is always having natural period of 2 seconds. And your building natural frequency, if I say 10-story building, it is nowhere near the two. So nothing will happen to my building. Of course, it may vibrate slightly. Resonance will not happen. The damage will not happen. It is a proven fact in Mexico. You please read some literature, you can understand that. In the last so many years, in our life itself, we have seen at least 2-3 earthquakes in last 100 years or 8 years, if you take more than 3 earthquakes happened. And all the damages are observed only in the period whose natural period is between 2 to 2.5. In all other buildings, no damages has happened. It is a very simple phenomenon to prove that resonance plays a very important role in earthquake. Mexico, why we take is it is repeatedly occurring, and the period also, most of the time, it is not varying between 2 to 2.5 only, all the time. So this is the same case everywhere. So if you are able to understand the frequency content of the earthquake, for example, in Bhuj, I can avoid that in all my building, and that is the biggest solution. That is the biggest solution you can ever have.
Okay, thank you, sir. I will refer all the things you mentioned in your answer.
Good. Thank you.
So any other questions? I think if there are no other questions, any questions?
Excuse me, ma'am. Hello, sir. This is Anusha.
Yes.
Now you are showing about that acceleration, velocity, that time, that plot graph. Right now, sir.
Acceleration?
Velocity.
Displacement.
And the time graph. Yeah,
yes,
displacement. Yes, sir. So once we get the earthquake, then we can get to know about the acceleration and the velocity, the displacement graph. So before that, how to analyze that, sir? Like, for example, if I'm taking one frame, portal frame like that, I wanted to take the gradual increment of the earthquake loads according to acting on that earthquake, on the frame.
It is highly possible, ma'am. See, for example, if you take SAP 2000 SAP program, structural analysis program, there is something called time history analysis. So in the today's program, it already has hundreds of earthquakes already built in. Suppose you say El Centro, the El Centro will be applied at the bottom of the building where your columns are fixed, and the response will be available for every time step. Suppose you say the earthquake is 40 seconds, and it will give for every 0.1 second how that displacement varies, like that. It will give you a full plot actually. So you will understand how things varies, especially in terms of displacement, acceleration or velocity variation will be coming out as an output in the time history analysis. And SAP 2000, why I am talking is it also has non-linear time history analysis. So because sometime the material may go to non-linearity in terms of hinges forming or whatever, that also can be included and then get a very good answer. So it is a possible only if you understand the time history analysis, which is given in any software. But since I used SAP 2000, I am just repeating that.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
One last question I wanted to ask you. We discussed that Indian code IS 1893 is quite apparent, and it gives some lower values. IS 1893 gives quite lower values.
Really, it is not a lower value. It is a design force. Please understand, it is not a lower value. It is giving a force which is called design force. Please understand that. That is why it is called design basis earthquake. That is called DBE. DBE, Z by 2 means that actually. So if you don't want that to happen, you have to remove the 2. That means then it is called a maximum earthquake that happens. So the code gives the guideline, because without that guideline, without that force, you cannot design at all. You need a number for designing a structure. Apart from dead load and live load, for earthquake, you take this. That is what code says. What I am trying to say is the force that you are taking is lower than reality. So that for which how to take care of that is also given in 3920 and many other codes. how to take care of them. 1883 also talks about that. Somebody will be explaining in the course, I think. So 3920 is going to tell you how to take care of this excess bending moment or rotation that in the beams and columns. How to be take care of that is given in 3920 clearly. So you should always read with 13920 as well as 1883 together. So that way it is okay. What I'm trying to say is you should keep in mind that the real force coming is going to be larger and you have a mechanism to take care. That's all. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, sir. Sir, while determining the design force...
Mr. Prashant, actually we have to join the next session at 11:15. See, actually I've shared the email ID of Professor Muthumani in the lecture.
Sure. Welcome. Welcome.
Yeah.
Sure, ma'am. Anyone can contact me, no issue. I'm very happy to reply and respond to you.
Yeah, there's no issue. Thank you, sir. So, thank you very much. So on behalf of SPC and on behalf of all the participants here, I'd like to convey my sincere thanks to you for accepting our invitation to deliver the keynote lecture. So, thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. With all your wishes, I'll leave. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Professor. Thank you.